Okay, thanks, Sanjo and everyone. Can you hear me in the back? Is that fine? Yeah? So my name is Elad Chazan. I'm from Princeton. And thanks for inviting me. It's a pleasure to give a tutorial about optimization, specifically optimization for machine learning. And this is designed to be kind of interactive. So please feel free to ask me anything and you know, shout in the middle. Yeah, already.
Shy. Not working.
So you cannot hear me in the back? No, I think this is only for the recording. Right? Yeah? So it's not supposed to amplify. Can you hear me fine? Okay. I'll try to speak louder. Acknowledge help from Sanjeev Arora and Yoram Zinger that helped me with the slides. And yeah, the type of optimization I want to discuss is that arises from machine learning. So the paradigm is that we have a machine that we want to train on inputs. For example, this is popular of recent. So we have a distribution over images, and we want to decide whether they are a car or a chair. So a distribution is modeled by, so the input is modeled by distribution over vectors in a Euclidean space, and the outcome of the machine is a label, which is a function applied to the inputs. And the difference from classical algorithmic theory that we all know and love, right? So we don't have an algorithm designer who is trying to look at the features and designing what is a car and what is a chair, but rather we have a function that maps the input, and the entire behavior of the function is determined by some parameters. And the different choice of parameters will determine whether we are classifying chairs and cars, or speech audio, or whatever it is you're trying to learn. And this talk is about training these parameters of the machine, usually some generic machine. We'll give a few examples. Many of the talks that will appear later on in the workshop are about these types of machines, but today, I think of them as a generic machine. We want to optimize the parameters in a way that is both efficient and will allow to classify examples that we have not seen yet. That's called generalization. So this is a brief agenda of what I want to do, and I might not do everything, but depending, so I'd rather give you a few good ideas and not complete everything I want to talk about. So we'll start with learning as mathematical optimization and give a few concepts. I'll talk about regularization, which is a word you might have heard and sounds mysterious, but I hope to give sort of a simple explanation of what it means. And finally, talk about more advanced optimization techniques. I will not touch upon a whole grid of things, bulk of things. Many of them are optimization. So optimization of Bayesian networks, inference, Markov chain, Monte Carlo, and all of that. So it's wonderful topics, but due to time, I'll not touch on these. Okay, so mathematical optimization is the problem of trying to find a minimum of a function. So the input is a function from some Euclidean space. I only consider Euclidean space, subset of it, to the real numbers. And the output is a point which is a minimizer. So a point in the set that is smaller than all other points according to function value. So in this picture, it's this. This is the minimizer over the cube. Now, how is the input represented? We're talking about complexity, computation, so I need to describe how it is represented. There are many ways. Maybe the most natural one is to say our function is given by a value oracle. So I give it point X, gives me the value. Oh. I'll try to speak less loud now. So that is one model. It is equivalent to the model where I give the oracle a point and it returns a gradient or a derivative of the function. So I'm going to assume that I can access values and derivatives. There are many examples of, we don't have to work in the oracle model. So there are many interesting examples where we know the function. For example, it could be a polynomial. If it's a polynomial, given by the coefficients, I can compute everything I want about it, right? All the derivatives. And even in this sort of non-oracle model, a polynomial already of degree 4 or 2 even, the polynomial of degree 2 is NP-hard to solve in terms of mathematical optimization in this definition here. so this is an interesting problem. It's NP-hard. It can model all problems in NP. wonderful model to work with in terms of expressibility. Now, we're not, so in this talk, we don't care about, or we do care, but not about mathematical optimization in the broadest sense. So we specifically care about problems that arise from learning, and that means that we have distribution of inputs and we want to find a mapping. So how can we think of this as mathematical optimization? Think of the function, for example, the deep neural net function, which maps image to a name of a person. So think of that as a function in the space of all possible weights over all the edges. Okay, so very high dimensional function, and it maps to a value. What is this value? The value is how many mistakes it makes over the distribution of the inputs. So in that sense, it is a mathematical optimization of a special form. So here is a mathematical form that we use often. The function that we want to optimize is a function of x. X is the argument. I will use it throughout. D is the dimensionality. And we're trying to find x. Again, this is in this particular case, it is an assignment of weights to the network that will minimize the loss, the aggregate loss over the world. So if we have a distribution over all possible images and all possible outcomes and a loss function that maps an example and weights of the neural network to a loss, then we want to minimize this loss over the world. So this is the type, it's a special type of function that we want to minimize because there is an average here. Average over loss functions, each of them might be simple because it takes only one example. So we want to minimize this special form. So maybe let me give a simpler example of a linear classification. This is really usually the first thing we teach in a machine learning class. So our data points are always the vectors in a Euclidean space. So I plotted them here in 2D, and they're given labels, in this case only two labels, blue and red. And we're trying to find the hyperplane that separates them, separates the blue points from the red points. So why? Because the outcome of this machine is the sign the direction of the point compared to the hyperplane, the side. Okay. So more formally, we're given a sample from a real-world distribution of images and names or classification, trying to find the hyperplane. It goes through the origin without loss of generality, such that it minimizes the number of mistakes. So why minimize the number of mistakes? In general, it might be the case that there is no hyperplane, right, that separates all the blue points from the red points. So we're trying. So we try to do as best as we can, minimize the number of mistakes. All right. So this is a mathematical form of it, trying to find a vector. This is the normal vector to the hyperplane. The norm is at most one. This is without loss of generality. Anyways, we care about the sign that minimizes the cardinality of the set, such that the sign of the point is different from the actual label. And I can put it in the form that I wrote before, right? So we're trying to minimize the sum, if I have a set of examples, sum of losses, where each loss of a hyperplane, an example, is given by the following function, this continuous function. So it's one if the inner product does not match the label, and one otherwise. Yeah?
On the previous one, you had an Rx term as well. Is that relevant?
On the previous slide? Oh, OK. Yeah, so this term is called regularization. It is very relevant, and it is used to prevent overfitting. This is just a rough statement. I will get to it in much more detail. But for now, we can forget about it.
And the regularizer is independent of the samples?
Yeah, usually, yeah. Okay, so yeah, I'll get to learning theory in a bit and then we'll define this more rigorously. But what I want to capture in this slide is how to convert a learning problem to an optimization problem and what kind of functions arise. Okay, so even this kind of toy problem is NP-hard, right? We haven't even got to deep neural nets or any of the more sophisticated machines. Already hyperplanes in binary classification is NP-hard. And maybe I want to give you an intuition why it is NP-hard and to motivate what we're doing in optimization. If all of these things are NP-hard, what are we doing? So, right, so just think of linear classifiers, right? When you sum up, this is a 1D kind of illustration, you sum up all these sine functions, they look like this, they can look very bizarre, right? They can have this shape. And if they have this shape, and let's say that you're in this point, you can sort of think that you can realize this is a local minimum of the function, right? But how would you ever know that besides this mountain over here, there is a lower point? This seems like a hard thing to do. Just intuitively, nothing formal here. But it motivates a search for a property that a local information will give us something about the global behavior of the function. That would be a nice thing to have, right? If we can move from local information to global, we would not be in this mess, and we could maybe have an efficient method for optimization. Okay, so the property which does ensure this, you have heard about it, I'm sure, is called convexity, and it is important exactly because of this fact, right? So local information tells you something about the global function. So here is a precise definition. A function is convex if and only if it looks like a smiley. So this means that you have at every point, right, the value of the function. So take two points. The value of the function in the middle is only lower than the average of the endpoints. Okay. And alternatively or equivalently, you can also say that if you take the tangent to the function or the derivative, it lower bounds the entire function forever. Okay, so this is an inequality that says that the function value at any point, doesn't matter where, is at least the continuation of the value at some point plus the linear extension according to the derivative. So this property is important because it gets rid of this issue here. And similarly, we can define convex set. Convex set also has this averaging property. If two points are in a convex set, then everything between is also in the convex set. So this is not convex. And convexity is very important. So as we will see in a minute, it allows for efficient optimization. And that is why people have replaced this problematic 0-1 function for linear classification and for any classification for that matter with functions that are similar to it but are convex. So for example, you could take the green line here is called the hinge loss. It is a piecewise linear function which is very, very close, well, at least when you're not too far away from the zero, to the 0-1 loss. It is convex. And these losses have been used, right, these are all loss functions that apply to hyperplane, example, and label, and they have been used in various important problems that you might have heard of about. For example, if you think of linear classification but replace this 0-1 loss function with a quadratic, then this is called regression, linear regression. If you add some regularization, it's called ridge regression. There are various subtleties. SVM, support vector machines, which was the most popular method maybe a decade ago, is exactly when you replace this non-continuous function with the hinge loss, this piecewise linear loss function, which is convex, and logistic regression, and so on. So there's been an industry of coming up with good convex relaxations about a decade ago.
So you don't need continuity, just convexity?
Just convexity, yeah. This is true throughout the talk, by the way.
And you don't need the derivative to exist because of this, you know, it's just as long as it's convex.
I need it to exist almost everywhere. So except for countable many points.
Sorry? The question was about continuity, not differentiability.
Yeah.
These are all continuous, no?
Oh, okay. Yeah. It is continuous, but you were asking about, I understood him even though he asked the wrong thing. Yeah. Okay. Any further questions? Yeah?
So here we're minimizing the loss over the sample points that were given.
Yes.
But the goal would be to minimize the loss over the distribution.
Correct. Absolutely correct.
So it seems like the best you can do is to work with the points that you have. But
So this is generalization theory, right? So statistical learning theory tells us that if you take a large enough sample and you work with a small enough hypothesis class, you will be able to generalize. So I will say something about it in a minute. This relates to regularization and so forth. But absolutely true, yeah. So for now, I'm thinking of only the training set, deterministic optimization. All right, so far we've just cast learning as a mathematical optimization problem and argued that convexity is algorithmically important. And what I would like to do now is start with algorithms. And the most maybe naive method you can come up with is called gradient descent, which all of you have heard about. And this method is a local improvement routine. You start with some point and move in the direction of the steepest decrease of the function. So now I'm talking about pure mathematical optimization. No learning, no generalization, nothing. Just minimize the function. So the steepest descent direction is called the gradient. In high dimensions, every coordinate, you take the directional derivative. So gradient descent is defined this way. At any point, you move a little bit by some eta. This is called the learning rate in the direction of the gradient at that point. And if you are optimizing over all of Rn, you're done, you know, continue doing it. If you have constraints, maybe you want to minimize the function from a subset of Euclidean space, then moving in this direction might step you outside, right? In which case you have to return. And how do you return? You do the most natural thing, which is to project. So take the closest point inside to the point outside. So xt plus 1 is the projection, the closest point to xt minus some multiple of the gradient. Very simple algorithm to define. And this is its property. All we need is convexity. We do not need differentiability, except for countably many points, as per the question. So as long as some necessary condition holds, gradient descent converges in the following way. You apply this algorithm to some function f, then f, after t many iterations, taking the average point, is at most the global minimum plus something that looks like 1 over square root of the number of iterations. And the constants here are independent of a number of iterations. They basically measure the Lipschitz constant of the function. So it's not too crazy. If you look at the distance between two points, it's not too large. And the other constant is the diameter of the convex set if you're working over a constraint set. And otherwise, it is the distance from the initial point to the final optimum. Any questions about it? So this is such a simple method and theorem that I can actually prove it in 4 or 5 lines. So let me do that. So the potential that we look at, this is very common, is the distance of the point from the x star. X star, I denote the global minimizer of the function. If we look at the square distance of the next iterate, y is obtained from x moving in the direction of the gradient. This is the square distance from the previous point minus twice the gradient times xt minus x star plus gradient squared. This is just opening, right? A minus b squared is a squared minus 2ab minus b squared. I just opened the square and the definition. So this is almost all we need. only one more thing, which is that the projection, so moving y to x, projecting onto the set, only decreases the distance to the optimum. Okay, so why is that? Yeah?
I think there's an eta squared missing.
Yeah, correct. Sorry, there's an eta squared here. So why is that? That's the called the Pythagorean theorem, right? So if you look at the three points, x and y that is obtained from x and the optimum, this defines a plane, right? In this plane, the angle depicted here is always obtuse because the set K is convex. Otherwise, you'd have a contradiction to convexity, right? We do not allow these kind of boundaries. So that's why this thing holds. And basically, that's it. So let's see. So, right, I'm missing eta squared. Pardon me. There should be an eta squared here. So just combining these two things, we get an inequality between the distance in Euclidean distance from one iteration to the next. Now we can write the definition of convexity. Let's look at f at the average point minus f at the optimum. Using convexity, right? So f at two points is always smaller than the average. You can write this, and using it again, it's lower bounded by the gradients, right? So this is just from convexity. And now plugging in this, just rearranging and dividing by two, eta, I get this equality, not even inequality. And the nice thing about the first expression is that the sum of distances, difference of distances, telescopes. Right, so I'm only left with the first and the last. And the last is negative. So I have something that looks like 1 over number of iterations, eta, plus eta times the gradient bound. And choosing eta, this learning rate to be roughly 1 over square root number of iterations, give me the bound. Any questions about this?
Okay. So this is. So here you choose a particular eta to achieve this result, right?
Right.
So in the theorem, I mean, you have to be careful to choose.
Yeah, the theorem, let's see. I hope I wrote it. Yeah, so.
Oh, sorry, you said it.
This is the eta that you need to choose. I mean, maybe the continuation question is what if you don't know t in advance, right? Then you can take little, the current t that you are at, it's fine, also works. It's very robust, right? It's such a simple analysis that it is robust to almost anything that you do, and we're going to use it. It's a linear analysis. You can take expectations, everything is linear, very well behaved. That's what we're going to do next. Okay. Any other questions?
So also, it's not that you show that xt converges. You're saying it's conceivable that xt don't converge, but only the average converges, kind of to the right.
Yeah, that is true. So without assuming more conditions about the function, this you cannot show something else.
Maybe you should repeat the question.
Okay, the question was that what we have shown here is that the average converges, and not the last point. And under some further conditions about the function, you can also show that the last point converges or the average of the last few points converge. There are all sorts of extensions. Yeah, Alexander.
Can you actually prove that this is probably so? Can you give an example of a function when the average converges but the last point doesn't?
I can give stochastic examples that are so. Not deterministic.
Yeah, but deterministic ones.
I have to think about it. I'm not sure. So it is a tight in the stochastic setting, which is of interest to us, yeah. All right, but of course, computationally it doesn't matter, right? You have this, to keep a running average. Okay, so what have we seen? We've seen that gradient descent, right? So we even proved that converges in this rate, 1 over squared number of iterations. So to get an epsilon approximate solution, you need roughly 1 over epsilon squared gradient iterations. And this is even tight in general, even for deterministic functions. Okay. So, okay, that's wonderful, but it's not particularly suited for what we are looking for. So we're trying to solve problems that are of this form. We have an average of losses over our data. Maybe some regularization, maybe not. So these are called ERM, empirical risk minimization. We minimize the loss over the actual sample. But the data depends, the gradient depends on the entire data, right? So by linearity of taking derivative, the gradient of this function is the sum of the gradients of the individual points, and then we have to go over the entire data, and this might take a long time. Even though, right, the algorithm now runs is very efficient, linear time, right? Linear time times 1 over epsilon squared. But still, this is not, the constants are so big in machine learning that this is not fast enough. We really want to be faster. And I didn't talk at all about generalization, like Luca was asking. Okay.
So maybe, sorry, just like I'm missing a very basic point. So you said this doesn't work anyway, gradient descent. So, you know, instead of this function, you do like some other function. So you didn't tell us how big the loss from what you want to, like, differentiable functions and stuff. So because these functions are not convex, right? So you're saying this function.
I'm now talking about convex losses. I'll talk about non-convex in the second part
of
the talk.
You started with this, then you moved to this gradient descent, so I mean this transition, and now you're moving back. So what are these two transitions?
Okay, maybe the transitions confuse you. Let me repeat. Okay. So we want to solve a cast optimization. Machine learning is an optimization problem, right? Generally, it is not convex. Then I said in general, it is NP-hard, which is why I moved to convex, and I gave an algorithm for convex.
So L now is convex. So you did the algorithm for this
Yes,
function.
If it's not convex, I don't know how to solve NP-hard problems, you know, I'm sorry. I mean,
so you're not talking about
optimization? No, not yet.
So we moved away from that example, you know, linear regression, or not linear regression, but whatever, this linear thing. We moved away from this example back to the general problem on convex functions.
I got confused, but I think it's not confusing so far. Okay, the convex optimization, I gave an algorithm. Now let's see what will happen next. All right. So I want to address these two things next. More efficient and generalization. So what we're going to see now is I'm going to remain in the convex world and address efficiency and generalization. Next hour, we'll talk about non-convex. Everything convex now. Okay. So to talk about like the more interesting problem, I have to remember where our data came from. So it's not just a general function that we're trying to optimize, right? It came from somewhere. And this somewhere is the statistical learning model or PAC learning model. So in PAC learning, we have a distribution over data. And, so nature samples data from a distribution and gives it to us, to the learner. The learner has to come up with a hypothesis that will perform well in terms of the chosen loss function over the entire distribution. Not only what we have seen, but everything, right? So this is called the generalization error of a hypothesis, is the expectation with respect to an arbitrary distribution, I'm not saying anything about the distribution, of the loss. And we say that the hypothesis class is learnable if, you know, for every epsilon and delta, we can see not too many examples, polynomially many examples, such that with high probability we can come up with a hypothesis whose generalization error is at most epsilon compared to the best hypothesis in our class. Then we say that the hypothesis class is learnable in the PAC sense.
Here is the definition. I mean, you miss the quantification of the distributions. This is learnable with respect to this distribution.
Without regard, you know very well, right? So without regard to for any distribution, it doesn't matter. So for any distribution, this needs to hold. Okay.
The function should be the same function for distribution.
Yes, correct. So the function of epsilon and delta and the dimensionality of the hypothesis class should be true for any distribution. So it is important to understand that our optimization problem comes from this setting. They're not just, right? It's not an arbitrary function that we're trying to optimize. And I will even consider a setting which I think is simpler, and it will allow me to give you the more efficient algorithm as well as generalization in sort of one-shot proof. And this is called online learning in games. So in online learning games, very similar to PAC learning, we have a learner. This is an iterative game. Every iteration, the learner comes up with a hypothesis, and the adversary, we have an adversary, no distribution. Adversary picks an example, and learner picks suffers a loss. And now there is no distribution. There is no, so you don't need to worry about which distribution. No distribution. So what can we do? What we can do is minimize the regret, which is the difference between the total loss of the player and that of the best hypothesis in hindsight. And we say that an algorithm learns in this setting if the average regret goes to zero as number of iterations goes to infinity. How many of you have not seen this before, I wonder? Okay, so good. So yeah, so then I'm happy that I brought it up. So this is a very interesting definition. It's not clear a priori that it can be done, that there is any algorithm that can minimize regret at all, right, compare. But what you have to remember is that you compare to a benchmark, which is a fixed hypothesis, and your algorithm is allowed to change every iteration, new distribution, new hypothesis. So this is similar to the previous setting, very similar. As a matter of fact, vanishing regret in this setting implies generalization error in the PAC setting. I'm not going to prove it, but it's actually not hard to prove, very easy to prove, by concentration. So, so therefore, this is a stronger notion and also easier to talk about because there are no distributions. From this point onwards, I'm going to think about the loss for an example chosen by an adversary or from a distribution, doesn't matter, as a convex function applied to my parameter vector x, which is a hypothesis. Okay, so can we minimize regret efficiently? It's a natural question. It's different from optimization, right? I'm taking into account generalization as well, not only optimization.
So, sorry, let's change from H to X.
I just call, so, yeah, unfortunately, you know, there are many different notations in learning theory and in optimization. And in optimization, the parameter is always X. So I use X when I talk about optimization. When I talk about learning theory, we talk about hypotheses. So it's H, but it's the same thing, okay? So think of X as your weights for the deep neural network or the linear vector that you use to classify with.
Great. Oh, yeah. Okay.
All right. So, yeah, the answer is yes, given by Zinkevich, 2005. And there is a natural analog of gradient descent that can be applied to the online scenario, online playing a game scenario. If you recall the previous equations, this look exactly the same, like gradient descent equations. The only difference is that I'm now taking a step with respect to the gradient of the current cost function. So remember, there, in this setting, this is an interactive setting, right? I choose an X, the adversary chooses a cost function. I choose an X, adversary, cost function. So this is the adversarially chosen function. So maybe the first time you see it, it looks maybe strange. You take a gradient step with respect to a function, even though this function might never ever appear again, right? It was chosen for this iteration. Next iteration, God knows what the adversary will choose.
But you don't see the whole function, right? You just see the loss.
So right. So I talked about how can I access a function, right? And I said, in this talk, I'm going to assume that I can always see the gradient of a function at any point. I have an oracle. Now, maybe you only see the loss. This is true in many scenarios. This is called bandit optimization. Very simple extensions of this work, even for that case. It's an amazing theory, but I don't have time to go into.
Okay.
Any questions?
Could you go to the previous slide again and relate to?
Yeah. Relate, sorry?
Oh, I see. You call it loss, there, L there, I see.
Yeah, so
L is changing, right, in the next slide.
Right, so in a learning scenario, what is changing are the examples. Usually we do not change the loss function.
Okay.
The loss function is hinge loss, square loss, we don't change, there's no reason to change it. But the examples change. And I call the function applied to it an example with a fixed loss as L, FT. Yeah.
So what you call capital H here, the set of possible hypotheses, is what's called capital K in the next slide.
Correct.
That has to be convex for the analysis to work.
Yes, most times, yeah. There are actually amazing examples where it doesn't have to be convex. In fact, when the loss functions are linear, and you have then the, many times they do not have to be convex. There was another question here.
So the adversary chooses both the examples and the loss.
Yes. So loss, the loss is governed by the example, right? So if you want to think about, let me go back to this setting, right? So the difference from statistical learning theory to learning in games is that you have an adversary choosing the examples. And I think of the instantaneous loss function as a function of the example. This is a loss function, every iteration. Okay? Is this clear? It's a simple thing, but maybe confusing. So
you're saying, I mean, it's not a priori obvious, but here both people are judged by the same benchmark, HH star. Here you, in the online case, one, you know, it's kind of incomparable. You like move in both directions. It's like I'm allowed to choose different functions, but I'm penalized because, you know, the objective changes every time.
No, the loss functions are chosen by the adversary, not by the player.
No, but this point, the AP are chosen. So here it's like the attacker commits to the distribution and that's it. That's his strategy. Everything is chosen.
Yes, this is the more difficult, the more strict learning in games is strictly more general than pack learning, strictly.
But it's not obvious because here the guy has an advantage of choosing different HT every time. He has to choose one HT.
Okay, not obvious, but it is true. Yeah. So I said you can convert a regret bound to a generalization error bound. This is actually easy to do, but it's kind of outside. It's not optimization, so I'm not going to prove it, but I will give you reference at the end. It's easy. Basically, just concentration.
It's not obvious by definition.
It's not obvious, but not harder. Okay. Okay. Any other? Okay, so let's see why. So the theorem that was proved by Zinkevich is the following. The regret by this algorithm, which takes the gradient of the adversarially chosen function in the previous iteration, right? It might have nothing to do with the next iteration. The regret behaves like square root number of iterations. So the average regret is 1 over root t. Right? It's an amazing theorem. And as it is amazing, it is also easy to prove. Let's prove it. Very, very similar to the previous proof. So again, I'm going to look at the squared distance as a potential. Here, thanks to the guy who pointed out before, I didn't forget the eta squared. So the squared, everything is exactly the same. So right, I can open the square, and the Pythagorean theorem is still true. It's true. The set is the fixed set. Pythagorean theorem is true. The only difference is that the gradient here is for a different function every iteration. It's not the gradient of the entire function, only for one example.
Okay.
So thus, I can combine the two equations and use convexity to upper bound the regret by a sum of linear functions. So the linearization according to the gradient, because the convex function is above the gradient. And again, I have the telescoping sum plus eta times sum of norm, squared norms of gradients. And picking eta correctly, I get square root t. Exactly the same. It's an identical proof with the only change that the gradient is of a different function every time. Any question about this?
Capital G again? It's a max.
This is an upper bound on the gradient norm.
So it's true for every t. So essentially you can bound this for every t.
Yes, I assume a uniform bound. This is a very justified assumption. Maybe I should say something about it. If you have an image, the norm of the image is bounded, right? So you have a quadratic function that takes the image and the label and your classifier. This is bounded, right? You don't have infinite items coming from the distribution. So this is a very legitimate assumption. And furthermore, you do not need to know it in advance. You can tune it online. Okay. So, yeah, by the way, this is tight. Let me say that this is tight. Root T is tight. And this is not hard to see. I'm going to quickly glance over it. So think of two functions. This is to Alexander's question. So one of them is x, the other is minus x. And your convex set is the interval minus 1 to 1. Let's say you pick at random a function, every iteration, right? So any algorithm has expected loss 0, because with probability half, there is x, probability half minus x. But the best point in hindsight will gain from the standard deviation, right? So we have t iterations, looks like a Gaussian. You have a sum of Bernoulli variables, you're going to have a root t magnitude. One of them is going to be root t less than the other. So regret number. So regret is at least root t. So this is tight. Even for 1D and linear functions.
So I don't see how this answers my question in a stochastic way, because like, still it might happen if you have a right, like the algorithm in the end, you know, it has some point, right? And this point might be pretty good in hindsight. It's like it might get some.
No, this is not the answer to your question. This is just the answer to, this is a lower bound of the regret. You asked why the average point is can be, but this is also true. I can tell you afterwards.
Okay. So that's okay. Right.
All right, so good. So this gives rise to the most important algorithm in optimization for machine learning. It's called stochastic gradient descent. So think of a learning problem. Now I'm thinking of the real learning problem. I have a distribution, an arbitrary distribution. I'm looking at the expected loss according to some examples. And I want to minimize this loss. So a random example is denoted by FT. And we have proved the following, right? Regret is bounded with respect to any sequence of linear functions by root t. So taking expectation with respect to any arbitrary distribution, I can bound the regret by root t. This is the regret, and it upper bounds by convexity the function applied to the average point minus the best hypothesis, best point. So what have I shown you here? I've shown you that you can apply online gradient descent to a learning scenario. What do you have to do every iteration? You move in only one, with respect only to one gradient, right? One example. And on the expectation, you're achieving the same performance as full gradient descent, right? So, and you get a direct generalization error, right? So this is true for the entire function. So we have moved from complexity of, if we have m examples in d dimensions, md over epsilon squared to d over epsilon squared, with a slight degradation because we're now talking about expected loss and not deterministic, expected performance.
So just to make sure I understand, you're saying you take this problem where everything is chosen on average from one distribution.
Yeah.
The online problem where you pretend that the next example is this adversarial chosen function.
Correct.
Then you apply the same.
Correct. Yeah.
Maybe you can mention the perceptron algorithm. This is sort of a generalization of that.
Well, okay. So it's kind of, no, it's not really, it's related, but it's different. So in perceptron, the choice of direction we move in, we have to go over the entire data set and find the point that is misclassified, right? And then we move to it, right? So the perceptron algorithm for finding a separating hyperplane starts with an arbitrary hyperplane, finds a point that is misclassified, moves to it, find another one, moves to it, right? So it's an adversarial algorithm. It's adaptive algorithm. It keeps on finding a point to move in. This stochastic gradient descent is a much easier algorithm. It doesn't do any finding. Just takes a random example, moves along this example.
Okay, boils down to it, right? If you get an example that's not misclassified, then the loss is zero, so you don't move.
But you might make a lot of kind of empty iterations in this algorithm, right? Yeah. So in perceptron, you always make an improvement. Here you don't.
No, if it's not misclassified, you don't.
I'm saying that in perceptron, until you have reached a solution, you keep on moving, always. And here you don't keep on moving. Maybe you will not move. Similar, but different.
Sanjay, you're saying they're exactly the same, but the perceptron has a piecewise linear loss that's zero when you're on the right side. No,
there is another difference, right? In perceptron, you find an example. You go over your data set to find the misclassifying point.
But you could imagine you're just iterating over data, like this is your string.
Okay,
right?
but here, so I guess we are saying the same thing. It's kind of, I don't know if it's even worth the discussion. So here I'm assuming the examples are given to me, you know, by distribution, right? I don't get to choose them. Perceptron, you go over actively and choose them and so on. Doesn't matter. So we're saying the same thing. I call it different and you call it the same, but Okay.
maybe you could say if the loss has a zero gradient at the point where you see it, what do you do?
Then you do nothing. Right. But it still doesn't mean that the perceptron is the same as this. Okay, subtle issue. This is really a subtle issue, not important. Okay, but what is important is that I have described to you plus proved the most easy and basic algorithm in optimization for machine learning, which is stochastic gradient descent. Okay, very simple. So any questions about that before we move onwards? Yeah.
So you choose the step size in a specific way, right?
Correct.
And what happens to the, so presumably if it's larger than that, it will diverge.
Might diverge. In practice, it's hard to be too large. You take much larger, more aggressive steps than in theory. But theory, as I showed you, is tight, and it's 1 over root t.
Well, but if it's too large, it will just go back.
Yeah. There is no guarantee. Yeah, that's true.
And what happens to the bound if you make it smaller than the actual?
What is smaller? I didn't hear.
If you take I guess asking how do those bounds sort of depend on suboptimality of the?
It's kind of easy to, right? The proof is so easy that you can, you have a different trade-off here between eta and 1 over eta. So you can calculate. As long as it's diminishing with time, you get a guarantee. There was another question there? Yeah?
Just sort of curious about the history here. So the changing FT proof is from Zinkevich, 2000.
Correct. Yeah, it was actually...
What's the is it just folklore, the fixed function proof of grid?
So Nemirovsky and Yudin would probably be the earliest reference. And this goes back to, 70s or something. They didn't call it this, but all the ingredients are there. So Zinkevich sort of put it in a more modern setting.
So you are saying that stochastic gradient descent?
Stochastic gradient descent was discovered by Robinson and Monroe in the 50s.
Right.
Again, they didn't call it that, right? So Ambush was asking about adversarial regret minimization. But stochastic gradient...
It was known before Zinkevich.
Yeah, that, even that, I think it was known, by many people, including Manfred Warmuth, who has known it for a long time. This is a depiction of full versus the stochastic gradient descent, right? So full gradient descent sort of zooms in. This is the height map, topographic map of the function. And stochastic might sort of jiggle around, but it will eventually reach the minimum, and the cost per iteration is much, much smaller. So that is why it is the method of choice. And what I'm going to do next is talk about, I'm done with gradient descent. I'm going to talk about more advanced stuff. Okay, so regularization and gradient descent plus, which is this is what Sanjeev likes to call a generic name for everything that's kind of more advanced than gradient descent. Okay, but if there are any questions, by the way, about gradient descent, I'm happy to answer. All right, so what is regularization? When we have a learning problem, right, let's say we want to separate the blue from the red, and statistical learning theory tells us they come from a distribution, right, over data, and we try to come up with a hypothesis that separates the data in a good way, but the complexity of the hypothesis needs to be taken into account. So clearly, in this picture, the black line is superior to the green line, right? Because God knows what the green line will do after this point, whereas you can sort of imagine the black line will do well, even on points that it hasn't seen. And there is a rigorous justification for this. The rigorous justification is statistical learning theory, right? So we know that the hypothesis class has a dimensionality, and we know how many examples are needed in order to fix the best hypothesis in a class. And regularization is exactly this process of taking a large hypothesis class. So you can think of deep neural nets or something very expressive, kernel methods, classifying with polynomials. This is very expressive. You can express anything with it. But because it's so expressive, it might overfit. Right? So we need to control. So a way of controlling the size of the hypothesis class is called regularization. So I think this is a good, perfect, intuitive explanation. I'm going to give an explanation which I think is mathematically easier. It's coming from the online regret minimization world, and it's about stability. So I can show that if you do not add, if you don't regularize, if you don't simplify your hypothesis class, you're going to do terrible in an online game, which is why we're never going to converge. Yeah.
So I think it would be also nice to mention that, regardless of generalization, regularization also helps you make your function nicer for optimization, right? So that's another big use of regularization. It's...
Yes and no. So...
Okay.
So what Alexander is asking, is saying, is that regularization also helps you for just for the purpose of optimization. Because you might have a function which is maybe even not convex, right? You add a very strong convex function to it, it distorts the function in such a way it can all of a sudden become convex. So this is true. It's true that in terms of an optimization problem, you might go from hard to easy or from easy to easier, but in terms of, you always need to remember what is the goal, right? So in terms of like optimizing the real loss over the rest of the distribution, this is not going to necessarily help you, right? So in terms of generalization error, it might harm you. So there is a trade-off between
mentioning that people might have seen regularization in different contexts. So
okay, yeah, this is true. But of course, there is two considerations here. So the primary is generalization error. So that's what we're shooting for.
Ask a question about the big picture. So you define a problem without R. So you're saying that's a natural problem. So we have a space of X, let's say X could be linear function, so quadratic. Doesn't the space implicitly talk about the complexity of the curve? So if you talk about quadratic curve, the black curve would be inside and green curve is outside. So why? It looks like you already taken care of the problem by defining the space appropriately. So if you define the space of unbounded functions or whatever, then fine, but just define a different space and do it implicitly. Yeah. Why?
No, this is a good point. So many times in practice, you can take a simple hypothesis class like linear classification. No matter what you do, it's not going to solve your data. If you want to classify ImageNet with 10 classes of the images, a linear classifier is not going to cut it. It's too weak. So you have to move to more difficult kernels or deep nets. And then these classes are too large, right? So you have to restrict them. So a way of interpolating between the expressibility and optimization, that's regularization.
So you're saying it might be easier to add an extra kind of term as a heuristic component than to really figure out the
It's not only heuristic, it's necessary, right? Even from a learning theoretic perspective, you want to reduce the size of your hypothesis class.
Maybe introducing the notion of structural risk minimization is helpful here.
Of what? Sorry?
Structural risk minimization. That you think that you have a collection of classes, one of them is bigger than the other, and you take the and you want to optimize over the union.
Okay, yeah, so I agree with Shai, knows this very well, of course, but let me give you a simpler explanation, okay, instead of all of this hypothesis class. So simpler explanation, which you can see immediately from regret minimization in games. So you're trying to minimize regret. This is the sum of your losses compared to the best in hindsight. And I've shown you online gradient descent, which is actually not maybe a natural thing to do. It's an unnatural thing to do. Because how would the gradient of the previous function relate to the next iteration, right? What I do, if I had more time, what I do in the courses I teach, I ask the students, what is your strategy? And they all say the same exact thing, okay? They say, just take the best in hindsight. So look at all the functions you have seen so far. Whatever worked so far, use it again. Right? It's the most natural thing. And I love it when they say it because they're wrong. Okay, so it doesn't work. So if you take the best in hindsight, remember the example of the plus minus one at random, right? You could have an alternating plus minus x. Every time you choose one, I'm going to give you a minus x. Then you shift to, now x is one is the best thing. Now you're going to get a minus x. You're always going to lose. This is a simple lower bound on the regret of this method. So it fails. But this is, by the way, called the fictitious play in economics. Okay. And this is known by economists, I think Christos will correct me if I'm wrong. So this is known to fail. They've known it for many years, that it's fictitious play does not minimize regret. It fails. But it fails only for one reason. The one reason which it fails is this exact one that I mentioned, the instability, the fact that you move back and forth. If you don't move back and forth, it works perfectly. Okay. And how do you make it not go back and forth? By adding regularization. So this is my technical explanation. Let me show it more rigorously. So the following provably works. This was shown by Kalai and Vempala. If you take X prime, your strategy, to be the sum, the best in hindsight, including this current iteration. You don't know the current iteration, but suppose you did. This provably minimizes regret, has zero regret, this strategy. And now, it remains to say that this XT prime is similar to XT, close to it. And if they are close, we're good. So the regret is indeed minimized. You can minimize regret. But these functions, if they are linear functions, by the way, this happens only for linear. If you have like strongly convex functions that are very curved, this can be shown even without adding regularization. And this is an interesting point that was made even in learning theory recently by my student Tomer Cohen. So he made this point recently in learning theory. But for regret minimization, you have to add regularization if you have linear functions. So here is a modification. You do to pick the best point in hindsight, only up to t minus 1, not what you haven't seen, only what you have seen so far. But add to it some term, to the optimization problem, you add a term in order to make it stable.
So there is like the gradient at I, right, not at t.
Yes, sorry, yeah. And if you do add this regularization function, which is a strongly convex function, which has a structure that doesn't allow you to go wild with the decisions, then you can ensure stability. You can ensure that the difference in cost between two iterations is small. And because of the Kalai-Vempala observation, this will give you good regret bound.
Can I ask a high-level question? So this function R, is it like is it part of the optimization? Saying I have a natural problem without R, let's play with like a convex function R for which you can prove some guarantee, or you make like one heuristic, like random kind of.
Yeah, this is kind of open. You know, how do you choose the best regularization? I'm going to tell you one method of doing it.
Sorry, you are or you are not?
Yeah, I am. If I have, I have time. How much time do I have? 5 minutes, okay, yeah. So 5 minutes, I should be good. So, so this adds stability. And in economics, this is called, I think, Christos, correct me if I'm wrong, called smooth fictitious play. Smooth fictitious play. So this ensures stability of decision, which helps you minimize regret. As long as R has some property, which is called strong convexity, it really has a center of mass effect that pulls you towards one solution. So this is called follow the regularized leader. So without regularization, just follow the leader, do the best in hindsight or fictitious play. If you add regularization, this is called FTRL. And choosing, someone here asked about the function, choosing what kind of function can you choose? The most obvious choice is a Euclidean x squared, Euclidean norm squared. Very simple choice. And then it turns out that you get gradient descent back. So the two things are equivalent. Okay. Best in hindsight plus Euclidean norm squared is equal to gradient descent. And it's an easy computation. So look at the optimization problem. I minimize the sum of gradients times x plus a half norm Euclidean norm squared. You can solve what's written here, right? Because it's just a quadratic. Linear functions. So you solve this, what's written here, and you get sum of gradients. So your point has moved by the sum of the gradients, which means from iteration to iteration, you add the gradient. Then you project onto the set. So this is exactly gradient descent.
For linear cost functions.
For linear cost functions. Something can be shown even for convex, but I'm not going to go into it. So this is exactly gradient descent. Okay. And so, okay, why did we have to look at such a complicated thing for gradient descent? Turns out there are many interesting algorithms that you can recover by this paradigm. So the other is multiplicative weights. So if you have your convex set to be the simplex, and again, linear cost functions, and you take R to be the negative entropy, then minimizing over sum of gradients times x plus negative entropy exactly you can solve, again, take the gradient, equate to zero, solve these equations, and get that the point is the exponential of everything so far normalized. Okay? Normalized to be a distribution. So this is a nice sort of way to interpolate between different algorithms that we know. There is something even more general. So from, yeah.
What was the product in the previous slide? I missed that.
See?
It's a projection.
Oh, this projection means taking the closest point. By this I denote taking the closest point.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and it turns out that you can, there is a general family of algorithms that you can write for different functions. People have considered, there was an industry of coming up with interesting functions at some point. This was already, it was called mirror descent by Nemirovsky and Yudin sometimes in the 70s. And you can think of general functions that even are not strongly convex, but have, that define a Bregman distance, a Bregman divergence, and prove regret bounds for them. You can prove regret bounds in a generic way. Okay, so this begs the question, what kind of regularization should we choose? And let me tell you something about it. We don't know everything, but I'll tell you one thing that we do know. So if we have a generalized linear model, then the online gradient descent update is many times inefficient if we have sparse data. Sparse data is very common in text and many kind of interesting applications because it treats all the coordinates in the same way. So this motivates adaptive regularization is a way to cope with the practical issue of sparse data and theoretically the way of choosing the optimal regularization. So think of the RFTL form. And which regularization should we choose? So an algorithm called AdaGrad, which is used commonly for machine learning optimization, treats this as a learning problem itself. So choosing the R. So you can say, OK, which R should I choose? Let me think of a set of regularizations which are matrix norms. So matrices, let's say they're positive, semi-definite, and have trace to be the diameter. And you can treat this as a learning problem and iteratively modify the regularization inside the algorithm that is actually learning the problem. It's a sort of a double learning approach, which is very natural. If you come from the online learning point of view, it's a natural thing to do. I don't know which regularization, I will try to learn it. And one can prove that actually, this is the algorithm that you get. I'm not going to go over all the symbols here, but one can prove that a regret bound that is sometimes a factor of root dimension better than stochastic gradient descent, depending on the instances. So if you have a cube and sparse vectors coming online, you can improve upon the naive stochastic gradient descent by root dimension. Okay, so this is very effective in practice. And this is also, by the way, works for non-convex optimization. Of the data. D is the dimension of the data all throughout. Okay.
So in this bound, that's for the original problem without regret. Regret is just a technical tool to kind of give you the algorithm, but then at the end, when you compare the performance of that algorithm, you compare to the sum of this meaning, whatever, the sum of the data without regret. Right? The regret is just a technical tool inside the algorithm.
Yes.
If you compare with regret, that's kind of bizarre.
Yeah, so here I gave a regret bound. But you might as well also compare optimization error over the training data.
So if you don't, and you get the same bound.
You get the same bound, yeah. So yeah, it's kind of interesting. So the 1/T rate is tight. It is known to be tight since Nemirovsky-Yudin. but they said nothing about the constants, and the constants can be improved by this method.
One over root t.
All right, good. So we're done with the polarization. Next hour, I'll talk about gradient descent++. So let's take a break.